Welcome back to CNN in Time. What Gertrude Stein's Paris Salon was to writers, the Loft in New York City was to jazz musicians. In fact, for a brief moment, the Loft may have been the center of the jazz universe, a bastion of experimentation and improvisation, a little place where legends jammed and where solos lasted till dawn. Here's more from David Lewis.
Certain places in the world that only happen once and for a certain period of time, and David's Loft was like that. It was full of camaraderie and beauty and swing and good feelings and experimentation. It was one place at one time that one long, beautiful strain of activity occurred.
Composer and valve trombone player Bob Brookmeyer, a battle-scarred veteran of the jazz life, is making a return trip to the Village Vanguard and to a band he was once part of. But just a few blocks away from this New York landmark, in a time when bop was pop, Brookmeyer embarked on a musical journey that forged his sound.
This was a place that we spent years, many happy years, and many inspiring years.
This building in the heart of Manhattan's Flower District is now home to Bernie's Discount Center. But from 1954 to 1964, it was an artist's illegal loft that became the after-hours home for a who's who of jazz legends. Thelonious Monk, Zoot Sims, Roland Kirk, and many more. Captured forever by former Life magazine photographer W. Eugene Smith.
This was Gene Smith's floor. We had his dark room, was over there.
Mike Corral is the owner of Bernie's Discount Center. He remembers Gene Smith, who remained in the building until 1971.
When we first got to know him, he said, "You never disturb me when I'm in that dark room. I don't care what's going on. I don't care if there's a fire in the building. You do not disturb me when that darkroom light is on." This was the floor that was considered the jazz loft. This was the heart of the music. And they'd have jam sessions up here that would last all night long.
None of us thought we were doing anything deep or profound or anything. We were having fun.
David Young, the painter who opened his loft to the jazz world, often recorded the late night jam sessions.
I got a cheap piano for $50, had it tuned. You could do anything you want. You could play music and all hours. It was nonstop. There was always something going on in the building because we never locked the front door outside.
It was not just a jam session place. It was a place where the house of David, where David lived. And not that he was be-all, end-all, but he was the generator, and he was the very subtle and very silent, sometimes, guide to our experiences.
Young sublet one of the floors to pianist and arranger Hall Overton.
Hall Overton was very modern, very advanced. He was connected to Thelonious Monk.
Overton brought in a few more pianos. Once the word got out, the loft became an instant magnet for jazz players in search of a place to jam.
If you could play it or dig it, you could become part of the family. It didn't matter what race you were, what age you were, what, you know, cultural background, nothing. There was no restrictions.
On the next tune, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to feature on the valve trombone, Bobby Brookmeyer playing Darn That Tune.
Some of the guys didn't have regular jobs or official, you know, good paying jobs. And so it was important that we had a place to get together and relate, because that's the only place it would happen.
We were all
children of the Charlie Parker era.
Bill Crow was one of the regular bass players at the Loft.
I think we all felt that we were in a different part of the world than what we considered the square public, you know.
Was David Young's Loft important for your musical growth?
Oh, sure, sure. It gave me a chance to play with some great players and learn from them. And I remember one of the early days when, before I even had my own bass, I was going to jam sessions and playing on other people's. I'd wait for the bass player to get tired so that I could jump in and play on his bass. And I started to get a blister one night, and I said, oh, I better cool it, I'm getting a blister. And tenor player says, man, you're a bass player, you're supposed to bleed.
Things happened naturally, that was the good part about it. The playing was natural, the atmosphere was natural, and there were no such thing as important people.
One night, July night, hot July night, Monk is practicing the piano, playing pretty much by himself. And outside on the fire escape were two cats in heat going about their nature's way with all the yowls, etc. And Monk started playing harmonics with the cats' yowls. It was good time music, and it was pop music done better. There would be something would take over, an ecstasy, and it's something that can't be planned or created or performed nicely at Lincoln Center. It just happens. Well, in the middle of all our goings on and our wacky times, into the building moves Eugene Smith.
When Gene Smith was there, we didn't know who he was. It was just this depressed man who would sneak around taking pictures.
He was no enemy to alcohol, and he always dressed in black, and he had this kind of pencil mustache, a beret, a cigarette holder. I know he liked music, so one night I invited him up to one of the sessions, and he came up and with a whole bunch of cameras and asked if he could photograph, and I said, sure.
He called the Loft a unique piece of Americana.
Sam Stevenson, who researches the life of Smith, first wrote about the Loft for Double Take magazine.
What Smith really liked about jazz, and really much of his photography in general, it's about relationships and groups and the juxtapositions of the musicians playing off each other, and then Young's paintings in the background.
Smith, who died in 1978, captured over 20,000 shots of the jazz scene, where cultural icons like Salvador Dali or Norman Mailer would come to watch musicians engage in endless solos.
We would stay there until the energy ran out. And some people would, we'd leave, and some people, their energy had not run out, they might stay till the next evening, you know. And it was fine with David, he'd go to sleep, whatever, you know. So we were literally at home. I mean, not many people would do that.
Hal Overton had two pianos, and the pianos were directly under where my bed was. And he'd be there with Monk working out arrangements. And so I'd go to sleep at night hearing one of the most original piano players of our age inadvertently serenading me, you know.
The rhythm sections really built up some strength and endurance, and during all that playing, you're constantly trying to find ways to get a better sound, to get better in tune,
to spin your line out so that it fits what the piano player is doing, what the guitar player is doing.
Probably the greatest mover and shaker in the whole thing was Zoot, because Zoot would play with almost anybody.
Zoot was a famous drinker, and Zoot was fantastic because he could fall asleep on the floor after being playing a tune. He'd wake up 6 hours later and then be playing the same tune in the same tempo. You couldn't stop him from playing. He'd have his nose on the floor and still be playing.
Getting high was very popular in those days, and a lot of young musicians tried everything that came along, whether it was legal or not. I feel fortunate that I survived that, because I experimented around with some things that turned out to be too hot to handle. I felt I had been poisoned. I was afraid I was going to die. Then for a while, I was afraid I wasn't going to die.
This is Dave McKenna playing a Steinway grand piano. If you look in the background, you see a couple of light bulbs hanging from strings. You see clothes hanging from rods. It's just a mess back there.
He was so drunk, his head was on middle C, and he started playing like this. Everything from Brahms' Lullaby to Billy Boy to the Sheik of Araby, China Boy, all that kind of stuff. There's some kind of ghost or, you know, some kind of vibe there, you know. And it's still there, I think. You know, that neighborhood hasn't really changed all that much. Bill's Flower Market's still there.
You miss that loft?
Sure, I would love to have a place like that where I knew that people of that caliber were gonna be there playing. I'd be on my way there now.
You could not have today you could never repeat that kind of a scene. I miss that very hip, intelligent innocence of that period, which it may come again, but it's gonna be a long while.
The many photographs by W. Eugene Smith we just showed you are but a small fraction of what he captured at the Loft. Most of Smith's original work, some 20,000 photographs, is now stored at the Center for Creative Photography in Tucson, Arizona. In addition to his photos, Smith's archives also include up to 500 hours of jazz recordings from the Loft, virtually none of which have ever been heard by the public. If you'd like to hear more music inspired by the Loft or link to the Center for Creative Photography, just visit our website at cnn.com/cnntime. We'll be back in a moment.
Coming up on CNN in Time, how an international battle over fruit could spoil this man's dream of keeping his bath oil business afloat.
There is absolutely no connection between our product and bananas. And this is the whole issue that aggravates me more than anything else.
As CNN in Time continues.